Thank you. This is the last session of Founders Week 2022. How many of you have already been touched by God, moved by God, received something from the Lord, been encouraged? Yeah. So this may be your first session of Founders Week. We've had a phenomenal time. Last night, we had my friend Dr. Erwin Lutzer speak to us. And just in case you missed it, my favorite moment, I got a little clip, so watch this. This is my favorite moment of last night. If you want to see that message, you need to go. There's something there. There's very few people I let punch me. Erwin Lutzer's one of them. He has the right to do so. You know, when I started this... Some of you are saying, what's that all about? You got to go see the message. Watch the message. You know, when I started here at the Moody Bible Institute, I introduced my children. And I mentioned how they're a part of my family. I have three children. They're all here tonight as well. They're required to be here, by the way. Nah, just kidding. But something significant happened, actually, during COVID time. Some people have had some very, very difficult challenges, but something life-altering happened about 20 months ago. In fact, it was so life-altering that it actually changed part of my name, our schedule. It added I'm called a new thing now. And 20 months ago, I became a grandfather. And my wife, who's right over here, Dee, she became a grandmother as well. Yeah. And I told you that my kids kind of look like me, and I just wanted to show you. Some people think that my grandson looks like me. His name is Finn. He's 20 months old. I have a picture here that he kind of looks a little bit like me, doesn't it? So, to train him in the ways of... Some people say he does. So his parents started talking to him about the things of God in the Bible. And Dee and I wanted to get him his first grandparent Bible. So we got him a little Bible, a toddler's Bible. And my wife had him on her lap and she started reading Bible stories to him. And when I got home, I said, hey, I want to read some Bible stories to him as well. And so he was just fascinated with this little toddler's Bible. And we went through some of the stories. And then we sent him home, and my daughter calls me a couple hours later, and she said, Dad, what are you teaching Finn? I said, why? She said, he's running around the house with a broom saying, fight, fight, fight. I said, I'm teaching him the Bible. His favorite story happens to be David and Goliath. And now every time I see him, he comes up and says, Goliath? And I know what that means. We have to act it out. Now, he's only about this tall, but he wants to be Goliath. I'm David. So we have this little routine that I kind of twirl the stone and I throw it at him, and he gets hit in the head and he tumbles around. Takes him about 5 minutes to fall, but he eventually falls down. And when he gets up, he says, Goliath? I'm trying to teach him to be obsessed with Jesus, but that's going to come in some time here. Tonight I want to talk to you about spiritual shakeup. I believe that we are in a season that God is shaking us up to wake us up. Sometimes we need to be spiritually shaken in order to remain unshaken. And I want you to take your Bibles tonight and turn to Ezekiel chapter 37. Ezekiel chapter 37. As we enter a spiritual dimension of a prophetic vision, it has been painted by famous artists. It's been sung about in spiritual songs. You heard about it in Sunday school. It's a gruesome, ugly, nasty picture. Ezekiel chapter 37 reads like this. The hand of the Lord was on me. He's having a vision taken in the Spirit by the Almighty God. It doesn't tell us in Scripture that it's a vision, but we know that this is a three-dimensional, powerful vision given to this prophet. And he says, the hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of dry bones. That's your cue, dry bone guys. He led me back and forth among them. And listen, I saw great many bones on the floor of the valley. Bones that were very, very dry. And he asked me, son of man, can these bones live? Isaiah is taken to a valley. It's a valley like no one has seen before. Can these bones live? I think some of them are. He takes them to a valley, and this valley has got a prophetic message to it. It's not just a few bones. It's a valley that is full of bones, the Bible tells us. The French painter Gustave Doré tried to capture the scene in a painting called The Vision of the Valley of Dry Bones. He pictures in his mind what he thought that it would look like. It was not just a couple of bones thrown together, but this is a valley. In the depth of the valley, there's deep bones there. They're scattered as far as the eye can see. These are lifeless bones that symbolized a people that used to breathe, that used to walk, that used to love, that used to marry, that had children, that had life within them, their organs beat. It symbolized a people that were but are not anymore. It symbolizes a people that have ceased to be living people. Now, it's a valley of dry bones. The image that God gives the prophet Ezekiel is an image that has to do with a people that needs to be revived, a people that needs to be awakened. This is a message about gaining spiritual life back. It's a message about recapturing that which has eluded us. It's a message about regaining spiritual breath within us. It's a message to those that once lived, once sang, once breathed, once loved passionately, but now they're dry. It's a message of revival. It's a message of renewal. And so I want you, as I work my way through Ezekiel chapter 37, I want you to ask yourself, Lord, am I dry bones? And if so, breathe on me afresh, O God. I believe that as I read this passage, that there are three important insights into how God revives dry bones. And if you're taking notes, I want you to write this down. Number one, renewal, spiritual renewal, often starts by a startling revelation of our true, pathetic, spiritual condition. The Bible says, the hand of the Lord was on me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley that was full of dry bones. I want you to notice that this was a three-dimensional realm that shocks Ezekiel to the core. In the Jewish custom, it was a disgrace not to bury the dead. And so to take this proper Jewish man and to expose him to the bodies of the dead was even more shocking to him. But God oftentimes tries to shock us out of our comfort. Sometimes it takes a rattling, a shake-up, to take us from one condition to another. And so he forces Ezekiel in the spiritual realm to not only walk in the valley of dry bones that he felt was unclean and untouchable, but he takes him to the valley of dry bones, and in the spirit, he makes him take a close look at the dry bones. He's not just viewing it from an aerial view. The Bible says that he went back and forth among the dry bones. He said, he led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very, very dry. This is the Spirit of the Lord saying, Ezekiel, look close. Do you see these bones? Ezekiel, examine these bones. Take a close look at these bones. He went back and forth through the valley, seeing these bones that are disconnected, this lifeless bones, these bones that symbolize something that was before and is not anymore. You know, when someone takes you and you go back and forth and examine something, it's because they want you to notice, they want you to think, they want you to observe, they want you to take it in. Recently, I had to rent a car in a foreign country, and so they gave me the car, they drove up, and I've rented enough cars to know, hey, when you return it, they may say, hey, that wasn't there, and I don't know if it was there or not. So I've gotten a little smarter now. Now I examine the vehicles that I rent. In fact, I take a video. So now if I rent a car, I take a video, I look around, and they're wondering what I'm doing. I'm looking around the car. I'm saying, there's a dent, and there's a dent, and I see something over here, and I didn't do that, and this was already here. And let me examine it carefully, because it's important that I see the nuances of it. The Spirit of the Lord is taking Ezekiel in the valley of dry bones and not just glazing over this, but having him take a deep, deep look at something that was repulsive to him. Look deep. Don't turn your face away. Look at those dry bones. Glare at them. Examine them. I want you to take in the sight of this desperate, desperate situation. And then he says to Ezekiel, these were very, very dry bones. And by the way, if you know anything about corpses, if it's a recent body, it takes a while to decay. These were bones that had no meat on them, which means that they had been dry for a long time. Years of dryness. The Bible makes a point to declare that they were very dry, which means that this was not just a sudden situation that they found themselves in, a sudden death, but they had been dry for a long time. And then God asked Ezekiel a very interesting question. After Ezekiel has seen how desperate the situation is, after he's seen how dead these are, how long they've been in this condition, how impossible it is to revive them, then Ezekiel is posed with this question by the Spirit of God. He asked me, "Son of man, can these bones live?" That's a tough question to ask. Ezekiel's just been exposed to death, dryness, in the impossibility of this mass of bones coming to life. But Ezekiel is a man of God. He was smart in his theology. Sounds like a Moody Bible Institute grad. He said, "Sovereign Lord, you alone know." That's a great answer, isn't it? You see, Ezekiel, he had no confidence in the bones coming to life, but he did know something about the power of God. And so he throws it back on the sovereignty of God. He had no confidence that these bones could come alive, but he knew that God could bring anything to life. And so he says, "Son of man, only you know." This problem was not going away with a pep talk. This problem was not going away with a little praise worship. This wasn't a like, "Hey, get out of the bed. You'll feel better." No, they were dead. "Lord, only you know whether these bones can live again." And I'm convinced that when God wants to awaken us out of spiritual slumber, when God wants to renew our hearts, when God is doing an awakening of our spirit, oftentimes we fall into conditions that we don't even know we're in until the Spirit of God reveals that condition to us. I believe that the Spirit of God was telling Ezekiel, and by the way, Ezekiel was part of this category of dry bones. He was a part of the group of people that God was trying to revive. But God wanted to expose him to the deep darkness. He wanted him to know how bad it was before he was jolted to awaken. And I want to say this to you. I believe oftentimes God has to hold up the mirror. "God, it's not that bad. We're okay. Yeah, maybe we're not as zealous as we were before, but things are all right. Maybe I don't read like I was before, and it's been a while since I've worshiped with a lot of enthusiasm. Church seems to have lost some of its, I don't know, its attraction. At one time I felt really drawn. I was kind of hungry, but, you know, I don't know. It's probably the preacher. He's a little boring these days. I got a lot on my plate, God. There's a lot of things going on. I don't know. When I was young, I was zealous and enthusiastic. I'm a little more mature now. I don't go by my emotions that much anymore. Yeah, I have a lot of other things in life that take my priority. I still believe in God, and I haven't fallen away. Yeah, maybe I'm not as zealous as I used to be, and maybe things that bothered me before don't bother me anymore, but maybe I've grown a little bit in maturity. Maybe that's it." And then God says, "Look." Look. I believe that God was doing that with Ezekiel. There's only certain things that God can do. When I first came to Chicago, I've told you this story before, some of you. I was 21 years old, a graduate of the Moody Bible Institute, found myself in the southwest side of Chicago, back of the Yards neighborhood. Not a neighborhood that people were running to pastor in. Most people were running out of that neighborhood. But I found myself in the small church in the southwest side of Chicago, fresh with a degree from a Bible college, full of zeal in my heart, believing that people needed me and that I had a call of God on my life, and so I threw myself into it. And I visited people, and I witnessed to people, and I talked to people, and people were, it was strange for people to call me pastor. I was 21 years old. One lady came in and said, "How come you look like you just got out of high school?" And I said, "Well, it wasn't that long." And I was going and going and felt like I needed to solve, heal people and reconcile marriages and lead people to Christ and do that, found myself doing a lot of stuff in 6 months of pastoring. I was dry. I was tired. And I was ready to quit the pastorate. I got sick. I didn't have insurance. My grandmother convinced her doctor to see me, and he said, "Son, young man, you're exhausted." And I remember he said, you need a week of rest is what you need. And I remember laying on that couch complaining to God. Have you ever complained to God? We call it prayer. Really, it's a complaint session. I was complaining to God, "God, I'm doing this, and how come I don't feel the strength, and I'm depleted and don't have the energy to go on." And God did this to me. And you know what I realized? That I was trying to do in the power of my flesh what could only be done in the power of the Spirit. You know what I realized? God convicted me and said, "You know, you've been working a lot, but you barely talk to me. You know, you've been doing a lot, but you barely worship. You've been doing this in the power of your own strength, but you barely depend on me. If I were gone, you wouldn't even notice I was gone." You know, that was a realization. I thought I'm a pastor doing a good work, and God revealed to me the depth of my dryness, the depth of my pride, my fleshliness. I wept, deeply wept, for a couple of days, repented, that I had been trying to do what God could only do in my own strength and power, that I was really dry bones, and that I really was not breathing the life of God in me, and that I really needed to start trying to do less and come into God's presence more and depend on Him to do the work and Him to fill me and walk in communion with Him. And I vowed before God as I got up, "God, I'm going to pray more, spend more time in Your presence. I need You more, God, because I am dry bones." Something funny happened. I feel like I worked less, but more happened in the spiritual realm after I got up, because there's a difference between doing it in the power of the flesh and the power of the Spirit. So not only does renewal often start by a startling revelation of our true pathetic condition, but secondly, the prophetic word of the Lord is the catalyst that God uses to set renewal in motion. And notice what he says in verse 4. After he had Ezekiel view the valley of dry bones and awaken to the true spiritual condition of Israel at the time, which he was a part of, then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord." And this is what the sovereign Lord said to these bones: "I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. And I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord." So now Ezekiel has this task of not only seeing how desperate the condition is, but he has the task now to speaking to skeletons. Have you ever felt like God asked you to do something foolish? Prophesy to that which is impossible. Speak to the valley of dry bones. Now, prophecy, sometimes when we hear the word prophecy, we think that it's about foretelling the future, and it has that element in it. But prophecy can be both the foretelling of what God is going to do, but also the forthtelling of what God wants you to hear right now. It has a dimension to it that sometimes involves the future, But it also has a dimension of being God's word for this moment at this time that you need to hear. And so God says to Ezekiel, prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. And I'm sure Ezekiel looked around and said, well, they didn't even have ears to hear, Lord. They don't have brains to capture. They don't have hearts to do this. But God said, prophesy to the bones. Every preacher knows that sometimes they feel like Ezekiel. And he says, here's what I want you to tell the bones. I want you to tell the bones that in spite of their current condition, I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. And I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. And I will put breath in you, and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord. Ezekiel, look at those bones and start saying, I know what you are right now, but God has a different destiny for you. You will one day breathe again. You will one day laugh again. You will one day rise up on your own. Hey, bones, Lord, nothing's happening. Hey, bones, one day, hey, bone, listen to me. God is going to raise you up, and you one day will breathe again, and there will be flesh upon you and tendons upon you. God, they're not listening. There's nothing happening. Hey, bones, the Lord is going to do something. Listen, you have a different future. It will be different. You see, Ezekiel knew very well the condition of Israel because Ezekiel was part of that group. You see, in 586 BC, the city of Jerusalem was captured by the Babylonian army, their archenemies, which it had conducted a three-year-long siege of that city. 3 years they had seized Jerusalem. And the walls of the city were breached. Judah's king, Zedekiah, tried to escape, and he was pursued and captured near Jericho. The Babylonians punished him by slaughtering the children before his eyes, and then gouging out his eyes, so the last thing that he ever saw was the slaughtering of his children. Then they led him to Babylon in chains. 3 weeks later, the Babylonians burned the city of Jerusalem, the holy city, the city of the temple, the city of David, the city with the great temple that Solomon built, this grandiose city that seemed to be the center of what God is doing now lies in ruins. The temple was burned along with the king's palace. The houses of Jerusalem, the city walls were torn down. The remaining people, except for the poor, the sick, were forced to march, and they were deported to Babylon. Among those deported to Babylon was Ezekiel. Ezekiel had seen the glory. He knew of the Shekinah glory coming in the temple. He knew of the glorious presence of God. He knew of a place that was called the city of God. He had heard the prophecies. He had been around it. He had been when this was a glorious people full of life. But now, they were a valley of dry bones. Never underestimate the power of God's living word. Because God says, speak, hear the word of the Lord. Can I tell you something? The word of the Lord is the catalyst to awakening. The word of the Lord is what God uses to penetrate our hearts. The word of the Lord is what God uses to awaken our spirit. The word of the Lord has the breath of God upon it. The word of the Lord has the power of God upon it. Listen, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16 says, all scripture is God-breathed. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 says, for the word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates to the dividing of the soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of our heart. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. That's the power of the Word of God. Spurgeon said, if we want revivals, we must revive our reverence for the Word of God. If we want conversions, we must put more of God's Word into our sermons. It must still be His Word upon which we place our reliance, for the only power which we will bless men's lives lies in the Word. You see, I believe that if revival awakening is going to come to our nation, going to come to our lives, I believe that God's church in America has slumbered. We are considered one of the most Christian nations in the world, yet there's a slumbering within the body of Christ. The passion, the zeal, the holiness in living, the commitment to live on mission. We don't live in a nation that is a Christian nation. People talk about political solutions, cultural solutions, social economic solutions. I believe that the greatest solution for our country is a church that's revived by the power of the Spirit of the living Jesus. So the Bible says that Ezekiel said, so I prophesied. I prophesied as I was commanded. You say, well, Pastor Martin, nothing seems to be happening. Prophesy anyways. No one seems to be listening. Speak anyways. It doesn't seem to be getting better. Preach anyways. I'm not seeing the effect of it. That's all right. God's Word never comes back void. Don't stop preaching His Word. Don't stop proclaiming His truth, because there's power. There is power in the Word of God. And so the Bible says, Ezekiel says, so I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was noise, a little rattling, and the bones came together. Come on, I can just imagine Ezekiel. He's prophesying, one day you will live again. This is not your destiny. One day God is going to rise you up in a way that you never, oh, you don't look like. Oh, don't give me that face, because one day God's going to change that smile of yours. There's going to be something different in there. And the Bible says that he's going out prophesying, preaching, nothing's happening. Listen, I'm talking to some pastors that feel like nothing's happening in your church. And I want to say, keep preaching the Word of God. Get on your knees. Ask that God would bring a renewal, awakening, revival to your church. It's Spirit-empowered, passionate pursuit of God and His Word that awakens those that are dead. And so he preaches, and as he's preaching, the Bible says that he doesn't see anything in the beginning, but he keeps prophesying. Listen, I know I'm talking to someone here. Listen, if you're a pastor listening to me, I want to say, keep preaching. It's not over. The mission is not over. Don't resign. Don't give up. Don't quit. Keep preaching with authority. Get on your knees. Ask that God would bathe it in supernatural power. And you continue to proclaim the unadulterated, inspired Word of the living Jesus, because it has power. And he continues to preach, and suddenly there's a rattling. He probably thinks it's a mouse, a rat. He hears a little noise over there, and he keeps preaching. He's prophesying to the bones, and then there's a little bit more rattling, and then a sound, and then he hears a lot of rattling start happening. And then something starts to happen. It seems like the bones start moving and they start attaching to one another. And then bone comes onto bones. And so that encourages him some more. And so now he preaches with a little bit greater faith, because he sees a little rattling happening. And so he preaches more. And the more he preaches, and with the greater faith that he preaches, then it seems like more is happening. And bones are moving together. And he feels like he sees a little bit of a hand move there, and a little bit of a leg move as these bones start attaching to one another. And he preaches with all of his might, and then when he's done preaching, there it is. A bunch of dead people. They're better than they were, but they're pretty bad. Now they're corpses. It's a valley full of bodies. Hear me. The Word had brought them together in a place to receive the breath. Listen, they needed the Word first, but they couldn't live without the breath. So there are churches that preach the Word, and it's important, and you bring things together, and there's a semblance there, there's a connection there. But there's another element that God spoke to Ezekiel about, and I want you to see the third point here in verse 9. Listen, it's the Spirit of God is ultimately the agent of awakening and sustained life-giving renewal. So look what happens here. They're making progress, but they're not there. Now there's a valley of dead bodies instead of dry bones. There's now the possibility of life, but it lacks breath. And then God says to Ezekiel, prophesy to the breath. I want you to notice, he's not prophesying now to the bones. He's prophesying to the breath. Do you see the difference? Prophesying to the bones is he's speaking the word of God to people. Prophesying to the breath is prayer. He's calling upon God to do something that he cannot do in the natural. So there's the Word of God that brings it together, and now there's prayer or calling upon God to say, God, you have to do what cannot be done in the natural. And so he says to him now, he says, I want you to prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the Lord says, come, breath, from the four winds and breathe into these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded, and breath entered them. And they came to life and stood on their feet, a vast army. Commentator Taylor says the second action is tantamount to praying. As Ezekiel besought the Spirit of the Lord to effect the miracle of recreation, to breathe into man's nostrils the breath of life, this time the effect was devastating. What preaching in itself failed to achieve, prayer made a reality. Listen to me, listen to me. I want you to hear me very well. You can be sound in orthodoxy and dry in spirit. You can have right doctrine and be dead. Now, you need to have right doctrine, and you need to divide the Word of God accurately. It needs to be in its context. There needs to be study, diligent study of the Word. But never, never believe that just because you have the right doctrine or you're in the right camp of orthodoxy, that that makes you right with the living God, because we can be right doctrinally and very, very dry spiritually. The Word of God was spoken to these dry bones, but they needed something more. And so the Spirit of God said to him, now prophesy to the wind. The breath in Scripture has always been symbolic of the Spirit of the living God. In fact, he said, prophesy to breath. In the Hebrew word, it's ruah. It's translated breath. In verse 5, 6, 8, 9, and 10, it's breath. The Hebrew word is the same word, means breath, spirit, and wind. So he prophesies to the wind. He says, wind of God, spirit of God, spirit of almighty God, do something that we cannot do. Come with mighty power, breath of God, and breathe into these people that have truth but have no life, O God. And then something starts to happen. Do you know that D.L. Moody was preaching and evangelizing and leading people to Christ? And one evening at the close of one of his messages, two women approached him. And they told him that they were praying for him. And they kept telling him after every service that they were praying for him. And he started to get irritated. And he said, why are you praying for me? Why don't you pray for the lost? They said, no, God has placed on our heart to pray for you. Can I tell you, there's something powerful when two older saints get together to pray. If you have a prayer ministry, hey, never underestimate or undermine people that pray. These were two older women that got together and they said, no, we're praying for you. He said, what are you praying for me? We're praying that you would experience greater spiritual power in your messages. Well, that was a little bit of insult to him, but he got a little bit convicted about it. And so he started joining them in prayer. And the Bible says that, the testimony, the history says that in September, he started praying with them every Friday at noon that he would pray and minister with greater power because he felt like he needed greater power from the Spirit of God. A month after he started praying, hello historians, listen to this. A month after he started praying, on October the 8th, 1871, Moody Church was destroyed by the Great Chicago Fire. Be careful what you pray. All that Moody had done, built, destroyed in a fire. The world that he knew was shaken. But he had been praying, oh God, may I minister with greater power. And so God shook his world. Historians tell us that Moody, the next month in November, went to New York, devastated by the fire that had happened in Chicago, that thousands of buildings were burned down in this city. 300 people died. It was the Great Chicago Fire. And Moody was shaken to his core because of this. And so he was in New York, walking around the streets. He was raising money to rebuild the church in Chicago. But what was most on his heart was just this desperation to have more of God. And as he walked down the street of a busy New York street, he felt like the Spirit of God, because of his desperation and calling upon God, suddenly came upon his life with greater power. He sensed that God was doing something in his life. He rushed to a friend's house nearby who had a room, and he stayed in that room for hours as he prayed that God would fill him in a fresh new way with great power. He talks about a joy that came over him that's undescribable in that time. And then these are his very own words. I cannot describe it. I seldom refer to it. It's almost too sacred to experience. I can only say that God revealed himself to me, and I had such an experience of his love, I had to ask him to stay his hand. I went to preach again. The sermons were not different. I did not present any new truths, and yet hundreds were converted. Yeah. The breath of God. The Bible tells us that he prophesied. And I want you to notice, I want you to hear this. This is really important. Man, I'm drawing this to a close, so stay with me. This is really important. I believe there's some of you today that the Spirit of God is saying, you're dry. You need to have the Word. But listen, you can't do this in your own power. You can't have a healthy marriage in your power. You can't walk in purity in your own power. You can't do your job in your own power. You can't maintain your mental health in your own power. You can't preach in your own power. You can't be a decent human being that loves God in your own power. I don't care if you were raised in a church culture or not. It's not about your power. It's about the power of the living God. The Bible says, I will pour out my spirit on you and you will live. And I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I am the Lord and I have spoken and I have done it, declares the Lord. I want you to notice as he preached, as he prophesied, as he asked the wind of God to come, the presence of God to come, that these bodies that were there became a vast army. I can almost even hear the drumbeat of that army. I can almost hear it, but I don't. Now I do. I want you to know that God started to raise up. The breath of God came upon this. The bodies were there. And Ezekiel is saying, come breath of God, come breath of God. And as he calls upon the breath of God, he starts to see movement. And now he sees over there a hand that starts to twitch and a leg that starts to twitch. And he keeps prophesying, come breath of God. They need your breath, God. They cannot do it without you. God, sweep among these people. And then suddenly a knee jerks over there. And he sees a head pop up. And over there he sees another head pop up. And now there's dozens that are popping up. A knee comes up. And suddenly the first one stands alive, fully clothed. A soldier of God. And then another person pops up over there. And another person pops over there. And another one. And another one. And now they're rising up. And now there's an army that's standing up front. And the Bible says that it's a vast, powerful army. This is not just people coming to life. This is people coming to mission. They've been resurrected because they have a call and a mission to restore all that God has called them to restore. And now this army is marching. You hear them clapping. You hear their feet. You hear the noise. They have a purpose and a mission. It's the people of Israel, but it symbolically represents us. Let's stand together. Come on, everyone on their feet. I believe that God is raising a people in this generation that will do the work of God for him. God is raising a people in this generation, breathing in a people today that are in mission for God. God is beginning to put within us a call, resurrecting the dead, bringing us to life in Jesus' name. Because we have a call, we have a mission. Until every single person on earth has heard the gospel of Jesus Christ, we have not finished. We will not be stopped until the glory of the Lord fills this earth by his power and in his presence. Keep going, drummer. If you are here today and you say, Pastor Mark, you know, I've been a dry bone, but I believe that God is calling me to life. And I have to admit that I've been dry. Maybe you've walked away from your calling, but God is saying, you know, you need to restore your calling. I'm speaking to some of you tonight. Your heart has not been soft to the promptings of God. The voice of God has been muffled by all the noise in your life. The fire in your heart has died down to just embers. You have been slow to obey, lethargic in worship, lagging in the word, reluctant in your witness, irritated in your relationships, making excuses not to engage in community. You have minimized, excused, blamed, avoided, rationalized your spiritual lethargy and dryness. You blamed it on your age. You blamed it on your church. You blamed it on your pastor. You blamed it on your spouse, your circumstances, your friends, the culture. But tonight, the Spirit of God is challenging you to take a look at yourself and respond to his voice, to his word, and to say, I am responsible for my spiritual condition. I will not remain in dry bones. I will arise, I will hear the shaking, I will rekindle my calling, I will serve and seek God. I believe that God is raising some people like that. If God, if you know that you're dry bones and God has spoken to you tonight, here's what I want you to do. I need a volunteer. Just make your way up these stairs right now. Could you, someone that says, I know I'm dry, but God is awakening me. Come on, don't be afraid of it. Don't be ashamed. I know I'm dry, but God is awakening me. Come on, I could take two or three or four or five. I know I'm dry, but God is awakening me. I know I'm dry. I want you to pick up one of those skeletons. Pick up one of these skeletons. I know I'm dry, but God is awakening me, restoring my call, reviving my heart, stirring me with greater passion. Come on, we don't have a lot of skeletons. Go ahead, you could take them off. Yeah, oops. You could take them off. Go ahead, hold his head. This will work. I believe that God is reviving a people. I believe that God is reviving a people. And I believe that there's some, and maybe you're here today and you've never given your life to Jesus the Christ. You cannot be revived unless you're alive. And if you're here tonight and you say, Pastor Mark, I've never given my life to Christ. I don't know Jesus yet. I've never surrendered. I've never acknowledged him as my Lord and Savior. I've never publicly bowed my knee and given my life to him. Then I'm going to ask, if you need to do that, that you would join us on stage. Maybe you have already, but if you're here today, I want you to get out of your seat, say, excuse me, I need to give my life to Jesus. If you've never done that, then I want you, whether you're in the balcony, whether you're here, I want you to say, I need to give my life to Christ today, today. If you need to do that, did you make your way out? All right? There's anybody else? Now, here's what I want you to do. I want you to extend your hand to these people that are on the stage with me today. We're going to do something symbolic because I believe they're on the stage, but there's a whole lot of dry bones that need to be revived. I want you to know that you have a calling. Some of you have given up. Some of you have rejected. Some of you have let it go. You stop living in the calling. You stopped interceding. You stopped pursuing holiness. You stopped saying, God. Some of you have given up on callings that God had given you, and you've walked away from God-given dreams. Not because God changed his plans, but because of lukewarmness in your heart and soul. I believe that God wants to do something in Chicago. If we can live in a city that an 8-year-old girl gets shot in plain day, Melissa Ortega, know the name of people that have been violently massacred in our city because the decay, because the moral corruption, because salt changes things. The salt in our city needs to be more salty. We don't live in a Christian nation, but we are a Christian people called by the Spirit of God to live and walk in revival and renewal. So this is symbolic for a whole bunch of people. This is symbolic for a whole bunch of people. Listen, those skeletons that we have, I'm trying to think of a way for us not to hurt anybody here. Can you just throw those dry bones into the valley without hurting anybody? Just throw them. Just say today. Yeah, throw them. Throw them. They can get hurt. Yeah, go ahead. No more dry bones. No more dry bones. No more dry bones. No more dry bones. Can you raise your hands to the Lord together, along with everybody that's here on stage? Can you raise your hands to the heavens? We're going to close in prayer, and then we're going to allow Natalie to lead us in some worship here. My desire, my heart, and I need an army with me that will not stop preaching the word, that will not stop prophesying and asking the Spirit of God to move upon our lives and upon our city to revive us. So today we ask God that not only you would revive our heart, God, that we repent of our lukewarmness. Startle us with our condition, Jesus. But I pray that you would not only bring us to life, but that you would raise a vast army that's full of life and living on mission for you, God. A vast army that's unstoppable.